On the world's longest river, Africa's biggest ever dam is riling up countries downstream. The $5 billion Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam promises to transform Ethiopia's economy with over 5,000 megawatts of renewable energy once completed. But in Egypt, a country that relies on the Nile for over 95% of its fresh water, the dam is seen as a threat. And Sudan, a country amidst a civil war, is caught in the middle. Talks to resolve water usage surrounding the dam have repeatedly broken down in acrimony, with Egypt refusing to rule out military action.
It is the most politically powerful country that is the most downstream.
Here's what the true impact of the dam will be and why an agreement is proving so hard to reach. The Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam, or GERD, is capable of storing 74 billion cubic meters of water, roughly a year and a half's worth of water flow from the river it sits on, the Blue Nile. For years, Sudan and Egypt have been using the majority of the Blue Nile's resources in accordance to a 1959 agreement guaranteeing the two nations access to the river.
There is history here, and not all of it necessarily good. When the Nile waters were being developed or leveraged for use, the original agreements only took into account Egypt and Sudan.
Sudan was granted 18 billion cubic meters of water from the Nile annually for irrigation and the operation of its hydropower dams, here and here. Egypt was granted 55 billion cubic meters of water from the Nile, which makes up the majority of its freshwater supply for its residents. Ethiopia was not included in the treaty, but the GERD is the country's largest Nile project in history. It's raised fears of reduced water supply further down the Nile, thanks to its placement here, in western Ethiopia, right before the Blue Nile enters Sudan. Ethiopia began building the hydroelectric Grand Renaissance Dam in 2011, with funding coming mostly from its own citizens. By 2020, the country had started filling it. Ultimately, the dam's reservoir will be about the size of Houston, Texas. Once commissioned, the dam's production capability is expected to double Ethiopia's current electricity output. In a country where 60% of the population doesn't have access to electricity, this could revitalize the Ethiopian economy.
Ethiopia's had this idea of emerging as a developmental state, as a country that is able to industrialize and to export to the world. It's very hard to do that without having enough energy.
The dam is expected to produce so much renewable electricity that Ethiopia will be able to export the energy to other countries, including South Sudan, Tanzania, and Somaliland.
A big part of this project is, or has at least historically been, to sell power to neighboring states. Ethiopian governments have for many decades struggled with this lack of foreign exchange. And so the idea was the dam is going to help remedy this.
But for their downstream neighbors, Ethiopia has been reluctant to commit to any agreement guaranteeing specific water amounts. Sudan is buffered by higher rainfall, plus its access to the White Nile here. And the dam could also help the country prevent flooding events like these.
Sudan is stuck in the middle. To a certain extent, it shares Egypt's perspective of needing to preserve their water supply for their own agricultural purposes. But because of climate change, the Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam could provide an opportunity to help regulate flow in the Blue Nile if they're able to, of course, coordinate and collaborate with Ethiopia.
But without the necessary regulations, the dam could compromise water flow into Sudan. So the country has requested a legally binding agreement with Ethiopia regarding the filling and operating of the GERD. The Sudanese government did not respond to a request for comment. The situation is more stark for Egypt, which is one of the most water-stressed countries in the world.
It's a very strange scenario of being in a place that is so dependent on a water resource that is so far removed from where that place of use is.
Egyptian leaders want Ethiopia to guarantee that a similar amount of water will flow down from the Nile each year, even if that means releasing water in the reservoir.
Egypt has always insisted very strongly on having very specific numbers to talk about you know, water flows and what is deemed a breach of an agreement and what is not.
In the past few years, excessive rainfall has mitigated the effects of filling the dam.
The states of the region have been relatively fortunate because in a number of those years, aggregate rainfall has actually been quite significant. So they've been better than usual years.
A study found no significant changes in the surface areas of these two reservoirs in Sudan from 2021 to 2023. But experts say the real test will come during a period when rainfall is not as significant as these years, which is where the negotiations have stalled. The latest series of talks between these three countries fell apart in December, and the ongoing civil war in Sudan, which has left more than 8 million people displaced, has also stalled discussions.
Even if there is an agreement or there is some kind of commitment from the Sudanese government, they can't actually implement it, considering the state of conflict that's happening in the country.
Today, the reservoir is about 60% full, with the dam generating around 750 megawatts of electricity. The Ethiopian government did not respond to requests for comment, but it has announced that it will proceed with the fifth filling of the dam later this year. Still, experts say there is pressure on Ethiopia to compromise with its neighboring countries.
Growing investment, growing external trade, partnerships with the outside world has largely dissipated. And that's come under really significant economic cost for the population. And you could say, well, if the government wants to change that, it needs better foreign relations, starting with its own neighbors.
And without any future talks planned, Egypt has said that it would take steps to defend its national security if it had to. The Egyptian government did not respond to requests for comment, but experts doubt that it would take military action against the dam.
They bomb the dam, you have all that debris, a toxic material, potentially contamination, essentially, flowing in the river. Practically, it appears that they don't have much leverage, which is why they need to really come to terms with things or aspects of resolving this issue that currently they're very uncomfortable with.